Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 30th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We've got apologies this morning from our convener, Colette Stevenson, and from our colleague, Ross McCall. We move to Agenda Item 1 and decision-taking business in private, and we're asked if we can agree to take Agenda Item 3 in private at today's meeting. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you for that. Moving to Agenda Item 2. And our next item is an evidence session on the Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council Bill, SEAC Bill for short. We've already heard from two panels in our evidence-taking sessions previously, and we'll hear today from a further two. This is a member's bill which was introduced by Mark Griffin, MSP, on 8th of June 2023, and it is currently going through its Stage 1 process with our committee. The bill will create a Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council to advise Scottish ministers on employment injuries assistance. It is proposed that the Council would have three functions: to report on draft regulations for employment injuries assistance, replacing the Scottish Commission on Social Security's role in this area; to report to the Parliament and ministers on any matter relevant to employment injuries assistance; and to carry out, commission or support research into any matter relevant to employment injuries assistance. So I welcome our first panel this morning. So can I welcome Norman Proven, Scotland's Associate Director, Employment Relations, Royal College of Nursing, and Linda Somerville, Deputy General Secretary, Scottish Trade Unions Congress, who are joining us in person this morning. Good morning to you both. But also a very good morning to three witnesses who are joining us online. So can I thank Mike Corbett, National Officer NAS UWT, Lorna Glenn, Scotland Regional Officer Unite the Union Scotland, and John McKenzie, Regional Secretary Scotland, the FBU, for also joining us to help us with the scrutiny this morning. So good morning to you also. A few points just in terms of proceedings this morning. Please wait until I or a member asking the question said your name before you come in and make a contribution. That's for witnesses. Don't feel you have to answer every single question that's asked. If you've nothing additional to add, because it's been said by others, there's no requirement to do so. We're not trying to dissuade you from speaking. It's with five witnesses. It's just a time constraint matter. Please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn on your microphone before you do start speaking. And for witnesses online, if you wish to come in to answer a question, could you put an R on the chat box in Zoom, and the clerking staff will make sure that I'm made aware of that to give you the opportunity to come in. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? That includes myself, I should note. So we will now go to our first theme in relation to membership of a possible SEAC committee. So I will just open. Does the bill give SEAC the right balance of scientific expertise and other interests to sit on the committee? And could I maybe, let's go with the witnesses online in the first instance, perhaps, because the default is to go to the people in the room. So can we perhaps go to Mike in the first instance?
Yeah, thank you, convener. I think from our point of view, it's absolutely essential that workers are at the heart of this. For too long, our feeling is that their voices have been ignored in this sphere. And in particular, there's been a lack of research under the existing system into women's health and safety, which means that, you know, many female-dominated jobs and sectors seem to get ignored by the existing benefits. So, you know, the notion that workers are to be at the heart of this, we would say, is absolutely essential. Workers and their representatives. Alongside that, yeah, obviously you do need health professionals and others to be a part of it. But from our point of view, current balance looks right. And the most important fact is that workers are at the heart of the new Employment Injuries Advisory Council.
Thank you. Do any other witnesses online wish to add to that? Okay, I don't see anyone taking that on. Norman or Linda, do you want to come in? Do you think the balance is about right? Or maybe just add that we'd heard last week that there was perhaps was a gap in terms of those involved in occupational health across all workplaces in Scotland. There was perhaps a bit of a weakness in relation to good quality data collection to be used for analysis. So there was certainly a bid there, I think we got last week, for occupational health to have a role. Norman, could I perhaps take you in at this point?
Yeah, I don't have any comment to make about the occupational health element of it, but certainly in terms of the makeup of the committee, having an equal number of employer reps via trade unions as equal numbers with employers would be helpful. I think trade unions are in a unique position with their experience of supporting workers who have been injured at work, that would be crucial to the committee.
And Linda Somerville?
Yeah, similarly, I mean, I think it's really important that we have employers there, but also the main thing about having trade unions there is they can actually speak to workers' experiences. And I know through our experience with dealing with the Scottish Government and lots of politicians, particularly closely during the pandemic, that was really, really important in helping shaping government's thinking and a lot of the engagement that we had, where we heard directly from our affiliates, our trade unions, what was going on the ground in a way that government or others couldn't have. And that advice was taken into guidance. So it's a really good example of saying why it's really important that trade unions who have first-hand knowledge of what's happening on the ground can help to shape the policy and make the decisions.
Okay. Thank you. And I'll move to Katie Clark now for some further questioning.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay? Sorry, I think there were slight problems there technically. My question is for Linda, and it is about the composition of the body, because in the SGEC submission, the suggestion was it should be 50% of the body that's trade union representatives. I appreciate that different unions operate in different sectors, so we'll have knowledge of different occupations. But could you maybe explain why you think 50% is the right kind of level, and maybe say a bit more about what you think the composition of the body should be overall, given that we understand the UK body is very dominated by people from a scientific and academic background?
We're looking to say that, you know, whilst absolutely Katie is right, there's a role that there needs to be expert advice, but we would argue that expert advice does come from the workplace, you know, where people have got, you know, decades of experience and understanding of what the occupational risks are, what the factors are, what happens in the workplace. And that's why we would argue for that. In terms of how that composition is made up amongst our unions, and that's for another discussion, obviously, but, you know, because we represent all sectors and all unions across Scotland, then, we, you know, we would look to try and make sure that that's as equitable as a representation the same way as it is for everything else that we do.
Thank you.
Any follow-up questions from that, Katie?
No, I understand. I think that there is quite a wide issue there about composition of the board, but I fully understand the points that Linda's making.
OK, thank you. We'll move to Midi McNair now.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I want to kind of cover the issue of timing in relation to the UK industrial injuries policy. In general, things have, as you know, moved quite slowly. We've been told just recently that, you know, we're inheriting a kind of warehouse full of sort of paper files and legislation left unreformed for a number of years. To guide us, really, how we can bring quicker change into Scotland, can any of the witnesses comment on the reasons for such little progress? Is that down to expertise or just a lack of will in terms of, you know, reforming it? I'll pop it out to Linda first, if that's OK.
I mean, it's certainly not been a lack of will from our campaigning for things to be reformed. I mean, excuse me, it's probably, again, it's something to do with those that have a responsibility. There's obviously an issue here that's quite complex about devolution and about moving both the benefit and then the responsibility for it to Scotland when it's so intrinsically linked to other things. I know from a previous role trying to work on student support and improving student support through the Scottish Parliament, through Scottish Government, that we hit all kinds of problems whilst trying to deal with the DWP, because whilst it was a priority for Scotland for this to happen, it wasn't a priority for them. So I think some of the looking to the future, if when we move to do this, I think some of the complexities are around the resourcing, I think particularly around the DWP and what they've wanted to do. I mean, when we look at the system as it is just now, you've got a predominantly paper-based system for a variety of historical reasons. You've got a system that is overly complex, and you've got a system which, although there is a decline in those that are now coming on as new claimants, that just goes to show work isn't any safer at the moment. you know, people are not any safer at work. What that shows is that the system itself has been frozen in time. Whilst workplaces and work has evolved around it, the system has just been absolutely frozen. We definitely do need an electronic, digitalised system that's fit for purpose.
Yeah, it's absolutely antiquated, isn't it, though, back in the 20s? I think it's the late 20s. Norman, do you want to come in on that?
Certainly you're inheriting a system that is slow. There's no question about that. In terms of the people who handle the individual cases in our organisation, we hear that it's not responsive. In many cases, there is a lack of medical examiners, for example, to provide expert information about individual cases. And aside from that, the committee process itself appears to be quite slow. So, for example, a year ago, the committee, the UK committee, made a recommendation about four particular illnesses related to COVID. And to date, the UK government haven't acted on that information. We wrote to the DWP about that last week. So our view of setting up the committee in advance of the Scottish Government taking responsibility for the benefit will give you guys the opportunity to not only do this, but to do it well by reforming the way that it's done and not having such a clunky, slow, unresponsive system.
Indicated if you'd like to come in to add to that,
sure.
Mike, are you going to come in?
Yeah, sorry. Just on that point about speed, that's one of the reasons that we think it's vitally important for workers to be central to this, because I don't know, you know, how many thousands of women over the years had spent, you know, hundreds of hours trying to convince their own GPs that endometriosis, for example, was a real thing. So we believe that, you know, that knowledge that workers bring about their conditions would help to speed things up. And also the involvement of trade unions, you know, typically I think we are all pretty good at holding, you know, the feet to the fire of those in power. So I think that would probably help as well in terms of helping to speed things up from what is absolutely at the moment what seems to be a very slow and archaic system. Thanks.
Anyone else before we move on?
John McKenzie, I think Marie's indicated.
Morning, John.
Morning, all. Thank you. Just to very briefly follow up on the comments that have already been made in relation to this question, I think it really accurately sums up some of the concerns our own union has raised in regard to the submission that has come in, not concerns in relation to the bill itself, and concerns in relation to what needs to be done in replacing when the benefit is devolved and addressing our body overseeing that appropriately. Not only in terms of the makeup of the body, and we've already touched on having adequate trade union representation within it, but also making sure it's fit for purpose in regard to current work injuries and diseases, and it's reflective of that. I'm sure we'll get onto that later in the evidence session, but currently what we have is a benefit that's significantly outdated. So it isn't just a case of making sure that the benefit is devolved to the Scottish Government, it's making sure that when it is devolved, we have something that's more appropriate and in place for workers in the modern workplace, both reflective in terms of the gender balance of recipients of that benefit, but also in making sure that it covers a whole range of new injuries and illnesses that recent research shows is now a transparent in the workplace. Thank you.
Thank you. Given what I've described, all this complexity of it, it's certainly a sorry state of affairs, really, in terms of, you know, moving forward. But really what we're looking for is kind of safe and secure transfer. That's kind of the arguments that we've had. Do you think that that approach taken would alter the time scale required for the introduction of the Scottish Council? And I'll pop it back to yourself, John.
Sorry, just took a minute to unmute. Look, I think this is one of the really important points from our union's view of why implementing SEAC now is so important. I think it isn't a case of cart before the horse. I think it's quite the opposite. I think having SEAC in place in order to reform the benefits properly devolved and that we end up with a benefit that's fit for purpose in the modern day is essential. I think SEAC can play a really important role in that. I know this is going to be a key part of the evidence session, and it obviously has been in previous sessions before, but, you know, from our members' view, from our union's view, we see a real role for SEAC in that development, that bill, and I think there's an important role for both trade unionists and the wider council itself to play within that.
Anyone else want to come in on that? No.
I don't see any takers.
Okay, just to move on to my final question. I noted from the kind of written joint submission from the asbestos support groups, they're saying obviously ideally the consultation on EIA should kind of take place alongside that of the Scottish Council. Do witnesses see merit in that suggestion? And I'll pop it back in the room. Norman, do you want to come in on that?
I don't particularly have anything to say on that issue.
No. Anyone on line? No. Okay. Back to yourself, Chair.
Okay. I'm just wondering on that point. Obviously, the argument can be made, and I think Mr. Mason will pick up some of this later on in the evidence session, that this quite rightly is creating expectations from workers and trade unions across Scotland, that the list of conditions that will lead to receiving the relevant benefit will potentially significantly increase, and the number of claimants will potentially significantly increase. There's a reality, and I make no judgment in relation to it, that affordability might be part of that mix. Does anyone have any comments to make on affordability at all, Norman Provan?
Yes, certainly. A real example of that, for example, would be long COVID, particularly after the COVID pandemic, the number of nurses who have contracted COVID, occupationally contracted COVID at work, and now have long COVID. At this moment in time, we have people who are now losing their jobs because of that, because they're not fit to work. So at this moment in time, the Royal College of Nursing has lodged a number of personal injury cases on behalf of those individuals. So the issue of cost, if it's done through a proper benefit scheme that's administered properly, then it does reduce the risk of individual employers having a number of personal injury cases. We have somewhere in the region of 20 that are currently assisted, waiting for the emerging information about long COVID. But it would be better for people to be recompensed for the harm that's been done to them through a benefit that lasts for a lifetime than both employers and trade unions wasting time in court, spending money through a litigation process that would be entirely unnecessary if people who have been harmed at their work could get a benefit to compensate them for that. So the affordability thing doesn't just lie with what it will cost for people to access the benefit, it lies with the cost that might be incurred if you don't apply the benefit fairly to people.
Pushed on that because that's important to put on the record. And John McKenzie wants to come in also.
Yes, thank you. I won't repeat what Norman's largely made the point that I was going to make, and I won't repeat that. But what I would say is, I think I can, while the point of affordability is absolutely relevant, and I think Norman's covered really well some of the current risk that is within that, rather than just it being affordability through payments made through the benefit, I think a really important point for us to ask ourselves as well is, do we think the benefit in its current form, as it currently is administered, adequately addresses the ask of why it was originally set up? So do we think it is a realistic reflection where around 7% of claimants are female? Do we think that adequately reflects current injuries, illness and disease in the workplace, or do we think it doesn't? And if it doesn't, the matter of affordability has to come secondary to whether the benefit itself is suitable and addresses the purpose of why it was there. So an important point, I won't repeat Norman's point, but I think that's a key area to focus on as well.
I'm pleased I did nudge, because I've now inspired Mike Corbett to come in and add to that also. Mike, could you give me your comments, please?
Yeah, just to partly build on what John is saying there, the current benefit is unequal and discriminatory. I mean, the figures I've got here suggest that in the 10 years up to December 2019, only 13.5% of all new claims were made by women. So I mean, if you want to, you know, embed inequality in the future, then, let's talk about how much it's going to cost or not. I mean, the Scottish Government's own programme for government recently suggested strong and inclusive communities defined by equality and good opportunities are where the people of Scotland thrive. Communities work best when they work together to improve social justice, reduce inequality and tackle poverty. That focus on equality is vital, and perhaps that costs some money. Sorry, a cat in the way here. Perhaps that costs some money, but that's a good investment. And finally, the way that we would see the new Employment Injuries Advisory Council working would be that in future, with that, you know, involvement of workers, we might manage a lot of preventative work in the future. So if you take something like carpal tunnel syndrome, if workers themselves had been involved in an Employment Injuries Advisory Council long before now, that, you know, what was happening to them could have been identified earlier, preventative action could have been taken earlier, and that actually saves money in the long term. So I think it's a bit simplistic just to say, well, there might be more things that are put on the list and therefore it's going to cost more and therefore we can't do it. I think that's a bit too narrow a view to take.
So thanks for making that comment, Mike. Hope you'll appreciate it's our job to scrutinise all aspects of the bill, so we make no judgment on any of that. We need to ask the questions to come to an informed decision as a committee. So that's helpful to the committee. And Lorna Glenn.
Hi, thanks, convener. I'm just really echoing what my trade union colleagues have already said. I think, you know, John had mentioned the kind of 7%. I know Mike, you'd said 13 or 13.5%. Our figure as well is also 7%. And I think there is a lot around that, reducing inequality and the tackling of the poverty as well, because if it means that women aren't coming forward, if it means that, you know, they're effectively, you know, getting long COVID at their work, and then they're possibly going to be taking down a capability route, and it means that, you know, that's going to lead to poverty and inequality. So although I'm an officer within United Scotland, I'm also the Regional Women and Equalities Officer, so this is certainly a matter close to my heart. So I just felt I wanted to, the submissions so far have been excellent. I've not had a lot to say, but I just wanted to come in and echo that and just say it really strongly, and thank you for letting me come in.
Lorna, that's an initial point. We're obviously trying to avoid some duplication. It's important that you need to put something on the official record today. You should absolutely come in and just do that, which is what you've done there. So thank you for that. We'll move on now. Can we go to Katie Clark?
Thank you. And my question picks up on some of the evidence that we've already heard, because we know that the UK body is already looking at a lot of these issues. For example, COVID has been mentioned by Norman more than once, and long COVID. There's obviously significant issues around about cancer and other conditions relating to firefighters, and the occupational women's health issue has been very strongly made in this session. And one of the concerns is that if it is a scientific body, and it's very much a committee and a body that's made up of academics, that it would simply be duplicating work that's carried out currently by ILAC, that it wouldn't have different outcomes. So what we're trying to understand is what the added value of this new body might be if it was considering the same issues. And is it the case from what you've said already that you believe there would be different outcomes if the composition of the body was different? So are you suggesting it wouldn't be purely scientific evidence that would be considered, and there would be other evidence? And if maybe I go to Linda first, as she says to you, Z.
To back up that scientific evidence, I say I'll go back to the pandemic and the work that we did with government during that time. I mean, we were in meetings with the Scottish Government from the very start of March, around twice a week, and then that eventually was once a week, and then continued for, you know, at least 20 months. And what we helped to bring them was the evidence, which, while some of it may have been anecdotal, it was evidence that actually allowed them to make better decisions. Because the decisions, whilst they can have science in front of you, and absolutely we would defer to the experts on many, many occasions, and one of the strengths of this is that you'll be allowed to commission research, so that's where a lot of your academic work and your scientific work will come from, is from the research. But actually to see what that looks like in real life, for those that have got lived experience, can actually share their stories, tell their stories, and we can feed that in. I think it gives a much more rounded decision-making experience for people when they can actually hear from workers and their representatives around that, rather than it just being looking at science. Sometimes on policy, as we all know, things on paper can look a certain way, but they turn out slightly differently. And I've seen there's numerous examples that we worked with government during COVID where that was the case, where they were thinking about doing a certain thing, and we said, well, on the ground, we know that actually this is the impact it's having in workplaces, and therefore they took that into account as well as what they were being told, both by public health or indeed by scientific information that was around at the time.
don't know if Norman would want to come in because he has spoken about COVID a couple of times, and whether he thinks a different composition and a different way of doing it would lead to maybe quicker outcomes or different outcomes.
In terms of quicker outcomes and better outcomes, I would certainly hope so. I think trade unions are in a unique position to reflect the lived experience of people who deal with occupational harms in their workplace. And that's missing from a committee of people who only look at the scientific evidence around particular conditions. And it's been commented by members today in the committee about this being a fairly clunky process at the moment that doesn't work particularly well, is antiquated in terms of the way that it's recorded and maintained. So, for example, as trade unions, we can bring to the table a working knowledge of when the system doesn't work particularly well. What we know, for example, just now is that many people submit quite complex medical information about their individual case and get rejected. And then when we have an appeal against that, we have very high levels of being successful on appeal, and often the information that's been submitted the second time round is exactly the same as it was the first time round. So it suggests that there are some structural issues that I think trade unions could bring to that committee to help iron out those problems. I would guess that in Scotland we would want to do this well.
Thank you.
So, yeah, two of our witnesses, apologies for cutting across you, Katie, that wasn't my intention. Just in case you hadn't spotted, both John McKenzie and Mike Corbett have asked to make a contribution. Can we go to John first, if that's okay?
Thank you. So, look, I just tied together a couple of the points that have already been made, and I think it's a really important question. In no way, shape or form is this looking to marginalise the scientific role. I think that's absolutely crucial, pivotal part of setting up the council. I think it's strengthening it for a couple of reasons. So Mike touched on earlier, I think he made a really good point in regard to not recognising and addressing new and emerging risks within the workplace, both in terms of injury and disease, has the potential to lead to real financial burden both for government and more widely in the workplace. Beyond that, if we don't do that, now trade unions have a really key role in flagging up early trends of workplace injury and disease. We see that all the time. Make no apologies for it. The Fire Brigade Union have been heavily involved in our own DECON campaign, which has been flagging up injury and illnesses in firefighters and the likelihood of cancers, contributing to cancer, strokes, blood-related illnesses as a result of firefighters' work. Now, that's been evidence that we've seen firsthand, or maybe not evidence, but certainly firsthand experience of our members for a number of decades now. But it's taken a long period of time to ultimately be able to produce the data and the scientific evidence that's needed to progress it to the level that it has over the last 18 months. Now, it's only through the Fire Brigade Union working in partnership with the University of Central Lancashire that's produced that data, and then it gets us to a place where there is the data available for there to be a scientific contribution in that. Trade unions have an absolutely unique role in engaging with working people within their workplace. So we've got a unique role in both identifying when there are trends when people are becoming ill through their work, or maybe becoming ill through their work, and then in being able to provide access, a scientific access for that, for those members of workplace in large numbers, so that the suitable research can be done. So I think that partnership role is something that we're seeing probably lacking a wee bit in the current benefit prior to it being devolved. I think it's absolutely an opportunity for it to be addressed when the benefit is devolved to the Scottish Government. Again, I would just finish on the point. That's why, from our perspective, from the Fire Brigade Union perspective, we think it's so important that SEAC is set up in advance of the bill being of the benefit being devolved, because if we think there's a key role for the members of SEAC or the future members of SEAC to play in making sure that that benefit is devolved most effectively to deliver the original intent of why it was set up in the first place, which is ultimately to address workers who have suffered injury and disease through their work.
Mike Corbett.
Thanks, Convener. A couple of points. The first one, in terms of the idea, could decisions be different? Well, yeah, they could be different, but let's face it, that's for us anyway, that's no bad thing, given some of the decisions or lack of decisions that have been made by the Industrial Injuries Advisory Council. And that's not just us thinking that. There was a University of Stirling report, and this was many years ago, 2015, I think, that at that stage, the report's co-author, Professor Rody O'Neill, said the Industrial Injuries Advisory Council approach hovers between incompetent and wrong, the government prescribed disease scheme might just be capable of spotting a catastrophe, but does nothing to recognise, compensate or avert tens of thousands of personal, preventable and frequently fatal human tragedies. So, you know, there are things that that existing body does that we think it doesn't do very well, so decisions could be different. However, that doesn't mean we're dismissing, you know, all the scientific evidence, etc. If you look at what's going on right now in terms of COVID inquiries, we've got a UK COVID inquiry and we've got a Scotland COVID inquiry. And, you know, all of you around the table and ourselves and, you know, employers and workers across Scotland have an interest and an input to both of those. But they have a memorandum of understanding that they've developed to try and work together to avoid duplication. So, you know, to our minds, something of that nature, if it can work for the COVID inquiries, as it seems to be at the moment, we could apply that in the case of two advisory councils trying to work together. Thanks.
Katie, do you want to come back in on any of that? No. OK. Move on to... We'll come to you next day anyway, Paul, so if you've got a supplementary, you can do that just now, so we're passing to you.
No? Yeah. Thank you. Just, I think, off the back of that discussion in terms of current interaction with IAC at the moment, where trade unions have made requests for, you know, research or looking at certain conditions, you know, what has that interaction been like in terms of IAC? Has there been, you know, a pushback? That's maybe too strong a word, but perhaps a lack of interaction in terms of looking at those issues and trying to move them forward. Sorry, I don't know who might want to answer. Norman, you were kind of nodding there.
Yeah, I'm happy to come in on that. I go back to the example that I gave previously. IAC in the UK committee made a decision around four conditions related to COVID a year ago that have not been acted on. And we, along with the BMA, wrote to the DWP about that last week. So the example I gave about personal injury claims that are now being pursued through the courts wouldn't have been necessary if people had a confidence that the benefit was going to be applied properly to their set of circumstances. So at a time when people stood on doorsteps clapping hands and banging pots about frontline workers working through COVID, to have those people injured at their work and not be compensated for that feels completely unacceptable. So certainly our experience is that the response has been clunky and slow, and we would certainly hope that in Scotland we could do that better.
Okay. No need for anyone else to come in, but just the opportunity to do so if you wish. Okay, no takers. Paul, you've got the next line of questioning anyway. We'll pass back to yourself.
Thank you very much, convener. I think it really kind of follows in this vein, you know, I think around that kind of what value would be added by SEAC and by having this Scottish body. I know, for example, NASUWT had commented on how long it takes for recommendations to be made by IAC, and I think we've had some of that engagement there in terms of my first question. So I wonder if we can maybe explore just how could SEAC, you know, work faster and quicker to get to those sort of decisions that will make an impact for people. I don't know if Mike wants to come in just because it was NASUWT who had commented on the length of time that's taken at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, without repeating what I said earlier, we do think that the involvement of workers is key in you know, pushing to get quicker and more accurate decisions. The involvement of trade unions, we believe, often helps in pushing to get quicker and more accurate decisions. But also, I suppose, the one thing I would add is that notion of things often being better and being responded to more quickly locally. So our feeling would be, well, look, if you're looking at Scotland and you know, we've got a smaller scale of things to look at, then potentially that helps to speed things up as well.
Do you have any comments on that?
If I might, I would suggest in terms of doing it better in Scotland. One of the issues about looking at scientific evidence is always about retrospectively looking at what's happened as opposed to horizon scanning for what might happen. And it does seem to me that having trade union involvement where they see the types of cases that are coming through in real time would be useful, and perhaps it would be up to the Scottish Government for how it commissioned the committee to work. But they could perhaps, for example, look at preempting issues rather than just responding to things that have created harm.
I think that, I mean, that is an interesting point, because obviously one of the issues that's flagged is that sense of perhaps duplication or concerns around how duplication might occur. So, you know, I wonder if panellists have any views on how they might foresee those organisations interacting, I suppose, and collaborating. And I think that's possibly a good example about preemption. But I would guess that would need some form of engagement between, you know, IAC and SEAC. So can anyone also foresee a way to kind of avoid that duplication in terms of how we set these things up, essentially?
I'm deliberately leaving the pause to see if we get a volunteer.
I mean, I appreciate it's quite a broad question, but I think it's just the principle of, you know, following from what Norman said.
I think one of
the one thing I would add, that, of course, is that IAC can't give advice directly to Scottish Government. So if you're going to be responsible for the benefit in Scotland, it would make sense to have a body that can advise you directly.
Can I just clarify, Norman Provan, that's because they're not allowed to give advice to Scottish Government. It's not that they can't give advice.
I think
we heard evidence, I think in last week's evidence session, that some of the experts that would be quite keen to perhaps sit on SEAC might already sit on IAC, and our committees asked for information as to whether there would be a bar for them being able to sit on both. So is that your understanding as well, Mr. Provan?
Yeah, in terms of the Scotland Act, of course, IAC provides advice to the UK process and not the Scottish process. So if there was, I don't know what the rules would be about people sitting on both. I genuinely don't know the answer to that question. The point I'm making is that I would expect the Scottish Government to have a process in place where they can be advised.
Thank you.
Yeah, just following on from that, that's our understanding as well, is that at the moment that IAC has absolutely no role to promote, to provide advice to Scottish Government, to ministers at all. So we would definitely need a new body, and it's really about how that new body is formed and when that body would be formed in order to give that advice. And I think also looking at this now gives us the opportunity to do something well. You know, everyone can point, both industrially and across the occupational health and safety, to the failings that there are and some of the concerns, and particularly around time that things take, to the current system. So this gives us an opportunity to improve the system and make sure it's fit for purpose. And we recognise as well the complexities that there are around devolution, because some of the areas that this bill is inextricably linked to are still reserved matters, for example, employment law and occupational health and safety. And the SDUC and its affiliates, you know, we have continually supported calls for employment law to be devolved to the Parliament. So longer term, that is something that may also support the swift or the easier movement of some of these processes along. But in the meantime, we recognise that we need to see that whilst that's a complex area, we do need a body here that would have those powers that can actually advise ministers.
Any more questions?
No, at the moment.
Can I just mop up a couple of aspects of that? Now, a proactive approach to health and safety at work is clearly desirable for everyone. Workers and trade unions on the ground see in real time exactly what's happening, and they've got that lived experience. Absolutely. Where should SEAC identify gaps in employment law, gaps in health and safety legislation, whilst employment law is not devolved to Scotland, whilst health and safety legislation is not devolved to Scotland, should they have the power to make recommendations to the UK government where the powers do currently sit? Is that something you would like to see? You've put on record, Linda, some of you'd like this devolved to the Scottish Parliament. But in lieu of that, in the meantime, should any new body be making direct recommendations to the UK government also?
We imagine it would be helpful, because if this body that we are envisaging is actually going to be more efficient, come to better decision making, then surely any recommendations that they have, we would want them to share back to the UK and to make those recommendations in the way that other organisations do in Scotland, and indeed Scottish Government, obviously, and Parliament itself sometimes does feed into UK things. But whether they take that advice and whether they can enact on it is different. But we would certainly support that. I think it also falls into Scottish Government thinking about, you know, one of its big criteria around, or its priorities around fair work, and what does fair work look like in Scotland. So if we are looking at what is an inherently unequal and inaccessible system, where, you know, you have a hugely disproportionate impact on women, where it's all gendered in terms of both the lens that it's seen through, the industrial injuries that it covers, and indeed the processes that are accessible over there for women, we really need to think about how do we modernise that and change it. So if the government wants something that really matches their ambition to be a fair work nation, then we would want this to be as expansive as possible.
OK. One final question from me before we pass to my colleague John Mason for the final line of questioning. The Health and Safety Executive has come up a few times during evidence sessions. Last week it was described as the police and the policemen in relation to work health and safety, and there was a kind of almost a debate around how effective it is or isn't, or how visible they are in workplaces, making sure that health and safety is upheld. Is there a role for the Health and Safety Executive to be working with SEAC? Should SEAC be brought into creation? And is there more the Health and Safety Executive should be doing anyway?
I mean, I'll ask my colleagues to also follow up on this, because I think it's an important point. But I think what we have submitted as part of our evidence also to the COVID inquiry is about our lack of faith sometimes in the Health and Safety Executive at a time where it was much needed in Scottish workplaces and to be advising, because of a number of factors, including not only the underfunding of the Health and Safety Executive, the role that it should have had in terms of enforcement and being able there to protect workers didn't happen at a time when we needed it most. But how it would interact with the going forward is maybe something that we've not got any thoughts on at the moment, you know.
Okay. Before I move on, are there any additional... There's no need for any additional comments in that area. Did any other witness want to make a comment in relation to this?
John McKenzie.
Yes, just very briefly to follow up. I know it's not the main purpose of the evidence session, but I think it fits in very briefly to follow up on Linda's point. Certainly our own trade union has significant concerns in regard to the defunding of the Health and Safety Executive over recent years, last decade particularly, and the impact that had on its own role. Without getting into the specifics of some of the issues our own trade unions had, we've just recently, over the last 18 months, seen complaints Fabius Union has raised by the HSE take over 18 months for them to investigate and report back. And even then, the way they have done so, we're not satisfied with in terms of the evidence and the way they have gone about that. And that's very much, rather than any individual thing, that's very much in regard to, from our perspective, funding and in regard to the resources that the HSE have in comparison to what they maybe had 15 or 20 years ago. So I think, yes, there absolutely is a role for the HSE. I think it can work alongside any SEAC that is established. But I think there's also in many ways, I think it also underlines the need for SEAC to be set up as well, or certainly a similar body, because there are failings that we're seeing across some of the organisations that would be picking up some of the work that would be covered there.
Thank you very much. Now, I had said I was going to go to John Mason for the final line of questioning, but I know Katie Clark wants to come in. Not quite a related point, but I think it makes sense to take in at this point. Oh. Katie.
Sorry, yes. Listening to what's being said, the bill suggests a council of 12. Do you think that's the right size of a council? I don't know if anybody's got a view in that or has given that any thought. It might be something the SGC might have given some thought to, given that they've made a submission about the number of trade union representatives.
I mean, we really just looked at the proportions rather than the membership at that stage, Katie. You know, we'd certainly be open to discussion about it at a future stage, but, optimum numbers for committees and decision-making is of a great debate. So, we don't really have a view on the size at that stage.
OK. I know John McKenzie wants to come in, Katie, to Norman after that as well.
Well, just very briefly on that point, not going to pretend for a second that we're subject matter experts in terms of the numbers that would be appropriate for the committee, but I'd absolutely echo Linda's point in regard to having greater trade union representation. And what I would say is I think this just further supports the point of introducing the SEAC prior to the bill, prior to the benefit being devolved. Because there is, if we're being honest, there is going to be a wee bit of lived experience in regard to seeing what is suitable in terms of the numbers of individuals represented within that. Far better to do that by setting up the SEAC prior to the bill doing the benefit being devolved, having an active role in how that benefit is devolved and how it is set up, and also finding its own feet rather than retrospectively setting it up once it is done so, and then still having some of that early learning work ahead of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Norman Provan.
And just to say, no comment particularly about the size of the committee. I think the issue is about the composition of the committee rather than the size, not the number of people in the room, but having the right balance of people in the room with the right experience and the ability to have workers' voice heard would be really important.
Okay, and Mike Corbett.
It's less about the numbers. I wouldn't disagree with what my colleagues have said there. It was just briefly to touch on the role of the Health and Safety Executive, and certainly in schools, their approach to check on whether or not mitigations were in place was often to phone up some head teachers and say, are mitigations in place, and be told yes. So I think that example demonstrates the HSE often cannot be trusted to do its job properly. And if the HSE and the current IAC have flaws as we think they do, that again reinforces the need for the SEAC, we think.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Corbett. Katie, do you want to follow up on any of that? No. Okay. John Mason.
Thanks, convener. And I think it's my role to ask about finance. So if I can start with yourself, Mr. Provan, you were very enthusiastic about the IT and this whole system being run much less on paper and more on IT. And the setup costs for IT and the website are only £50,000, which seems quite low given, we know that IT can be very expensive. Have you any thoughts on that figure?
I don't know where the figure came from, John, in terms of assessing how much it would take to set up digitally. The logic, however, suggests that doing anything that was a paper-based system in this stage would seem odd. You're inheriting a system that you had no impact over how it would look, but certainly I would suggest that having some paper-based system in this day and age would be an odd decision. So I don't know what the cost would be for setting it up, but I certainly think a digital way forward would be the correct one to adopt.
I mean, we can ask future panels unless anyone particularly wants to come in on that point. Another figure is, because a number of you in your submissions have talked about research and the importance of research, and yet it's only £30,000 that's down for research on an annual basis. I don't know, Ms. Somerville, if you feel that's enough or...
Probably not, no. I mean, especially if we're going to look to have expert opinion in that sense from research, because often getting academic research doesn't come cheap, and quite rightly, because, you know, that's something that would need quite a lot of investment. Just on the IT point as well, I mean, I think looking at complex systems and how you begin to do this, setting up a website is one thing, but actually moving things from paper-based into electronic can be complicated. But there is a huge amount of experience out there that can be bought in and that we can get advice about. You know, I am actually a former IT worker and have digitalised lots of different systems in the past, working in the finance sector. So, you know, we're talking about, you know, there is experience to do that both within government and elsewhere, and it doesn't have to be the most costly of approach. And the system itself, when you look at the cost baked into a new system, the system is not about the data or digitalising the data. The cost comes in about functionality. If you want an incredibly complex system that has lots of functionality, then that is where the cost goes into the build of the system and the testing of the system. But that's not the kind of system we're talking about here. The rules for it can be applied fairly easily. There's not a lot of functionality in the system, and the data warehouse that would need to be built around that is a one-off cost that's not insignificant, is not the big cost of the IT system.
Okay, thanks. Now, the other issue with finance is that the actual cost of the benefits going forward, and maybe I can come to you, Ms. Glenn, because you, you seem to suggest, and a number of the witnesses have suggested, that there would be more people entitled to benefits going forward, and I don't know if you've done any work on what that might cost.
No, I wouldn't say so, John. No, finance isn't my area of expertise. I just think it's an absolute reasonable conclusion to draw that the fact that only 7% of claims that come forward are from women. I know it certainly doesn't well represent the members of our BAEM communities either. I know that's not really been mentioned in the session so much. So it would only be a reasonable conclusion to draw that it is going to open up for more people to come forward, and obviously rightly so, as far as we're concerned.
I mean, Mr. McKenzie, I think you've also talked about this, that there's more, especially with firefighters, people that might be entitled to benefits. Have you any thoughts about what that might cost?
Yeah, look, in terms of having an exact calculation, John, no. But I think the principal point, what I would see is absolutely important point in this, is these costs aren't going away. So what we've seen within our workplace, being really honest, we've seen a range of different responses from fire and rescue services, and the scientific evidence that the FBU has helped to produce over the last couple of years, in terms of either engaging really well, in some cases, thankfully not in Scotland, completely the opposite. But firefighters aren't becoming less ill because we're not paying them a benefit. And if they are, and our evidence suggests that they absolutely are, becoming ill as a result of their work, there is going to be a significant cost to that at some point in the future. Now, we've got to ask ourselves, do we want to address that now? And that also, and we've also seen as well, one of the things that comes about through having a role, a body such as this, driving forward legislation, driving forward how benefits are allocated, is actually has an impact on employers. All too often, we've seen that employers are driven, sadly, in many cases, through potential costs in the future. Now, ultimately, where we want to be is we want to stop people becoming ill in their workplaces. We want to stop people becoming ill or hurt in their workplaces. That's where there's real savings in the longer term. It's also to the benefit of the individuals themselves. But there's a number of pressures that we need to create in order to do that. We've seen that for many, many, many decades now in the workplace. It is reactive rather than visionary, all too often, in terms of employers addressing these issues. That's why I think it's really important, that the benefit accurately reflects how people are currently becoming injured or ill within their workplaces, because in terms, even from looking at it from a cost-saving point of view, that is by far going to be the most effective way in the longer term, rather than not addressing it now. So I think inevitably, if we have more workers becoming eligible for benefits, there will be an initial additional cost. Yes, I don't think any of us could dispute that. But in the longer term, I think that is absolutely going to save money in the long term.
So, I mean, I take your point about preventative. So this could save money both for employers and the state and so on. So if the scenario was that the council could only do preventative work and only give advice and only do research, but the total amount of benefits were staying the same, which I believe is about 78 million, would it still be worth going ahead if the total amount of benefits was staying static?
Yes, absolutely, because I think one of the problems that we're seeing just now through the current structures, the current structures are there, is that a lot of research isn't being discussed, or it takes an incredibly long time for a lot of research to end up being discussed. And ultimately, that's ultimately producing a greater cost pressure in the future. So, yeah, look, in terms of the finances and the specifics in regard to how the benefit is devolved, there are better witnesses in regard to being able to answer these specific questions. But I think primarily from our members' point of view, and certainly from our union's point of view, getting that evidence in front of politicians, getting that evidence in front of decision makers is a key role for driving change. And through driving change in the long term, we're going to be making better use of public finances, because we're going to be addressing issues rather than just being reactive to them.
Can I move to Mr. Corbett then? Because you're arguing, I think, that more women would be due benefits and more teachers. Assuming that the 78 million total benefit stays the same, could it be reallocated better?
I mean, first of all, we don't know what the level of numbers would be in terms of, you know, the increased access to benefit. But I would touch on a couple of points that I've made earlier. First of all, I don't think we should be embedding inequality. That's not part of the Scottish Government's programme for work and the Fair Work agenda. And as John has been saying, we think undoubtedly that the way that we're suggesting, you know, the new council should be set up is that there would be that preventative work, and that would have, if you like, a kind of cost benefit in the future. But what that means in the interim is difficult to say. But I think I would be very disappointed if we were simply putting a cap on the money and saying there's only a certain amount can be spent. Because if we do that, then I think automatically we're embedding what, you know, the failures of the UK Council and its approach. And I would hope that, you know, the Scottish Government would to be much more progressive than that.
And where would you suggest the extra money should come from for the Scottish Government? Would take it off teacher salaries?
I wouldn't want to do that, but there are various. I think that amount of money, although it's in itself, it sounds significant. I mean, you'd be able to tell me perhaps what percentage of the overall Scottish Government budget that is. I don't think it's huge. So I mean, we've seen in the past that suddenly, you know, you talk about salaries, we've been told in the past, oh, there's no money available, and suddenly there is some money available, and it wasn't taken off someone else's budget. So, you know, I don't have a simple answer for you, but equally, I wouldn't want us just to put, in my mind, an artificial cap on things, because I think that would just embed some of the problems we've already got.
Can I ask Ms Somerville? I was going to come to you anyway on that point.
See, yes. I mean, I think when we look at the finances, it's maybe just, it's quite rightly that the committee wants to examine this in detail, and so between us, we probably don't have these calculations. But I think if we want to, first of all, just bear in mind that, you know, the legislation that we're looking at and the processes that we're looking at, is rightly the committee examine it, but, you know, this benefit is around compensating workers for for non-fatal injuries at work, for disease, for occupation, or indeed fatal injuries at work, you know. So we've lost in Scotland 21 people last year who went to work one day and didn't come home, you know, and families shouldn't suffer that. You know, we reckon that there's over, you know, 43,000 non-fatal injuries at work last year in Scotland as well. So when we're thinking about the compensation that's paid, we have to look at that in the roundabout. How do we want a fair work nation to actually compensate those who, through no fault of their own, whilst at work, suffered from disease, occupational injury, or indeed fatal accidents? And thinking about the funding for it, next week you will actually see that the STUC has refreshed its tax paper, which we brought out last year, which said that the Scottish Government can, at the moment, in its current powers, not any new devolved powers, in the short term, have an income by increasing some of their taxes and introducing some new taxes, which they have legislative power to do, can increase its funding by £1.2 billion.
So, I was impressed, I have to say, with the STUC. Sorry.
Apologise, but just before you move on further with the line of questioning, John McKenzie had wanted to come in.
Right, can I just ask, pursue Ms Somerville for a minute, and then come back to Mr McKenzie. I mean, I did think the SDUC paper was very good on tax options and so on, but I mean, we still have a relatively fixed pot of money. So, would you say it was only if we raise more tax that we put more into the benefit system, or would you say we should be reallocating? I mean, the NHS has got a huge budget. We could take a bit out of there and put it into compensation.
No, I wouldn't be suggesting we take money either out of the NHS, but I think that there is, within the government's powers, they do have a way to raise more revenue and then look at how they distribute that fairly. And how that discussion happens will be up to organisations such as our own to lobby for where we think that money should go. But no, I would not be advocating it's cut from elsewhere, obviously.
OK, Mr McKenzie?
Just a couple of quick points. I mean, just to put on record, Fire Brigade Union absolutely supports the STUC's tax strategy as they have outlined it, as you've commented yourself, John. And look, if we're talking about a fair work nation, progressive government, I'm sure none of us would suggest that the best way of paying for a benefit is by cutting the salary, although I recognise it was tongue-in-cheek to a certain extent. But none of us would support the notion of cutting salaries and workers' salaries in order that they could then pay for their comrades' injuries and illnesses that they have developed in these very same workplaces. But on a more serious note, we wouldn't shy away from the fact that the Scottish Government, in inheriting or in this benefit is being devolved, are inheriting a benefit that is well overdue to have structural change to. You know, we touched on the fact earlier, but I think it's a really important one to focus on. 7% of claimants being 50% of the population, do we think we're inheriting something that is really fit for purpose? So if we don't think we are, if we don't think we are, and we are genuine about being a progressive, fair work nation, then we have to take the opportunities to address these concerns. And yes, it absolutely has to be financially sustainable. Of course it has to be. And I think that some of the STEC campaigning around taxation is a really strong part of it. But the primary place we have to start from has to be that the bill, the benefit is adequate in its current form. And the final point I would make on this, and without expanding too widely, and I think there are real Christie Commission learning points within this as well. And that's within, you know, if we address some of these workplace injuries, if we have key drivers, and unfortunately drivers often are compensatory, to having employers properly address the reasons why people are becoming ill and injured in their workplaces, then that absolutely has a contributory role in future savings across other government portfolios. So that's absolutely going to be a case. I appreciate that it's out with the current financial year.
Yeah, I think we're
year,
also just about out with time, I'm afraid. Thanks very much for that. Thanks.
Just drifting slightly, Mr. Mason. Norman Provan, you did want to come in.
I'll try and be very brief. We spoke earlier in the committee about the possibility of SEAC having a proactive as well as a reactive response, John. So I think that's an important point of it, because one of the things that you've heard throughout all of the evidence is that this is a benefit that hasn't modernised over time. There are new occupational illnesses that have not been recognised and been treated properly. And at the end of the day, if the £73 million or £78 million, I can't remember the figure that you used, has remained static, it won't necessarily remain static. But if it doesn't go up through this, it will go up through other things, either through the health costs of maintaining people with long-term chronic conditions or other benefits that people will have if they're not fit to work. So at the end of the day, the problem of financing this isn't going to go away by just saying the cost of this would be capped at £73 or £78 million and won't rise if more people don't join it. I think it's about recognising that workers, if they are injured at their work, should be compensated for that, and the opportunity to look and horizon scan possibilities for that and stop it from happening will do better to cap the cost than just suggesting that people won't join the scheme.
Okay,
thank you. We're almost there. I hope Mike had made the comment about teachers' pay. What might be just saying, I've moved to this committee from the Education Committee, saying that the money was found and it didn't come from anywhere else. I know £26 million to pay for the teachers' pay award in the current financial year came specifically from the colleges' budget in the current financial year, who lost £26 million. So I may leave that sitting. I'm not to open up a wider debate, but I think it's relevant to Mr Mason's line of questioning and also Linda Somersall's points in relation to this, about how we use the wider taxation powers in this place, but not just this place, but at a UK level as well, because there are Barnett consequentials coming to here. But I absolutely get that witnesses today have tried to articulate passionately and clearly what the right thing is to do in relation to worker safety across Scotland, and it's sometimes one for the politicians to look at a bit more detail about how that could be financed. So I thank all of you for your really important evidence here this morning. That, I think, is the end of this particular evidence session, and we will just suspend briefly whilst we prepare for the next panel of witnesses. Okay, welcome back, everyone. And we now move to our second panel on the SEAC Bill. And can I welcome Anna Ritchie Allen, Executive Director of Close the Gap, Tony Higgins, President of the PFA Scotland, Ian Tasker, Chief Executive of Scottish Hazards, and Professor Andrew Watterson, Occupational Environmental Health Researcher, University of Stirling. Thank you all four of you for helping us with the scrutiny of this bill here this morning. As with the first panel, we're not trying to deter anyone from speaking, but if all four of you want to make the exact same point that's been said, you might just want to indicate that. We don't always have to hear, but we appreciate sometimes you want to get things on the record, so absolutely where you need to do that. I might just start by opening up with a general question, as I did with the first panel. Do witnesses think the bill gives SEAC, if it's established, the right balance of scientific expertise and other interests that would be important when reaching decisions in relation to the benefit? And if you don't, what changes is perhaps desirable and why? So I don't know if someone wants to go first on that. Catch my eye if you do. Professor Watterson.
I think there's an opportunity here for SEAC, if it's established, to move on from where IAC is. I think that you need the scientific and clinical input, but you also need the input from those who deal with the problems, which isn't necessarily a sort of research element at all. And you also need those who are actively involved with the problems. I think we can see that with John Brown's submission from the Confederation of Shipbuilding and Engineering Unions, where he's talking about welding. There's knowledge there that may not actually be available to the scientific and medical community. They may identify problems. I mean, I just heard the reference to new hazards and new industries. Often it will be the workers in conjunction with the employers and also the researchers who identify these problems. So I think to have a broad range, as is suggested by SEAC, is a very good idea.
So no additions. Ian Tasker?
Just sort of support what Andrew said there. Our original position was that we thought it was potentially too small and might not get enough of the academic expertise. But I think following discussions with Mark Griffin and explanation of how that figure was arrived at, I think it would be a reasonable basis to move forward with should SEAC be established.
Do you want to say any more about that, Mr Tasker? I'm not remotely trying to be awkward, but obviously the member in charge of the bill, Mr Griffin, will give evidence to the committee about why he's opted to that number. And you've had a discussion with Mr Griffin to say that's probably about right. What's persuaded you? Because we need to ask Mr Griffin the same question.
I mean, I think it was down to the way that things seem to operate in Scotland, where these bodies would be substantially smaller. But I've also looked at IAC meetings and seen the breadth of expertise they've got, and you do wonder whether within IAC there is some duplication within the membership in relation to what they're actually bringing to the table. But again, you know, IAC and the evidence that they provided to the Scottish Parliament, to this committee, they said that, you know, they don't have a toxicologist on IAC. So no matter what number we arrive at, we are going to have to go outside at some point to get relative, you know, to get the kind of evidence that we need if that specialism is not on the committee.
Well, Mr Tasker, if maybe you're suggesting the membership, this is a starting point within the bill, but depending on what SEAC may be looking at, they have to flex up their membership to give that particular expertise, depending on what they're looking at.
Well, to me, that could either be done on a formal basis, which would mean increasing the membership of SEAC, or it could be done on an informal basis on a needs must, which I must, you know, I would assume that IAC have done at points if they're dealing with matters relating to toxicity.
Okay, and before I bring Tony Higgins and Anna Ritchie Allen, if you wish to add to that, are there any additions? So there's no need to see any additions, but are there any additions that you would like to see on? So Anna Ritchie Allen.
Sorry,
No, just very briefly, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes. That's okay.
I'm used to these European models in Brussels, so I'm never quite sure what I'm pressing. Be it by committee or by situation, that I have a lot of discussions with Amanda Capel, who many will know from the past in here, in creating Frank's Law. And it would be useful, I think, discussing certain issues. We brought somebody into those discussions who had a lived experience of dealing with that circumstance, and that's certainly something that we would advocate.
That's very helpful. Anna Challen, did you want to come in?
Not on additions, no.
OK, thank you very much. We'll move to Katie Clark now.
Thank you, and I'm very much picking up on what's already been said. In the previous evidence session, which you may have heard, the view was that 50% of the seats should be held by trade union representatives. The bill suggests a composition of 12. Could you maybe say a little bit more about whether you think the proportions are important on the new council and what you think those proportions should be, and in particular what the employer representation should be and the academic representation, because we've already heard about trade union representation. As I'm not in the room, it might be better if the deputy convener could bring in a witness who looks like they would like to respond.
Well, I think Anna Ritchie-Allen was trying to do that, and I may have cut her off inadvertently, so perhaps we can...
Yeah, no, sorry, and I can give a brief answer to that, but a kind of additional point on the composition of the membership itself, which is we were broadly supportive of the proposed breakdown of the membership, but I think what is particularly important is around having gender balance on the council, but specifically in the lived experience element, because, and this is a point I can return to no doubt in every answer I give, is around the invisibility of women's work-related injuries and illnesses in the system, in the benefit, and the opportunity, I think, with the establishment of this potential advisory council, because we know that when women's voices aren't round the table, that their experiences are often ignored. And so I think this opportunity has arisen to make sure that the advisory council centres that approach on women's experiences.
Thank you, Anna. Professor Waters?
Could I just support that? And I think it's also a reflection on some of the problems that have existed within IAC in the past. There's a term used that's called one-eyed science. Basically, I see the men and I don't see the women. It was interesting that when you took evidence from the IAC chair, she said that one of the issues was women's health. Now, IAC had prepared reports in 2004, 2005, and the researchers involved with that, and they'd identified, for instance, shift work and breast cancer. 2004, 2005. Here we are, 2023, and they're still talking about, well, perhaps women's health is something to come. So I think it's absolutely essential that we get the appropriate groups represented and start, and if it goes through, SEAC can be a very useful catalyst to press other parts of the UK to do things.
Another witness want to come in on that point? Okay. Katie, do you want to follow up on that?
Yeah, and just a follow-up in terms of why a different composition might lead to different outcomes, because presumably the science is going to be the same. You're going to be drawing from the same scientific community. So is it the impression I get from you is you think that the questions put to the scientific community might be different, and they might be asked perhaps decades earlier, from what's just been said, but this may drive research. Is that fair? Is that a fair reflection, or are there additional factors that you think may mean that there would be a different outcome from the current position that we have?
Is that to a specific witness, Katie?
I can't see who would like to come in, so I would suggest, would Ian Tasker like to come in on that?
Yeah, I think, you know, really, and this is maybe going back to if we set the number too low, you know, and it's quite rightly, you know, we have to ensure that some of the inherent inequalities in the current system are addressed. And I think it's right that people who have been subject to that inequality over the past are part of this body. So, you know, really, when I read the STUC's evidence, I said, well, 50% should be trade unionists. Then if the total number is 12, then 6 would be from trade unionists, 6 from employers, and there's no room at the table for... So I don't know, and I didn't hear the evidence that was given in the earlier session, but you know, my view would be that a balance, there should be 50% representation from trade unionists and employers, but you know, really, we have to be realistic. That should perhaps be either 6 or 4, with another 2 seats potentially for people with lived experience, people like asbestos groups, you know, but also leaving enough accommodation within that the voice of the academic community can play an important part in this committee as well.
Okay, thank you, Ian. Professor Watterson?
Yes, just picking up the points, I think there's a lot of science out there that hasn't been acted upon. And there's a lot of science that IAC has seen that hasn't led to a recognition of prescribed diseases, or indeed where they are prescribed, then compensation coming through. So you wouldn't necessarily need more scientists to do the work. I think what you would need is some of these other groups that have been suggested for this committee identifying where things have gone wrong. And I just come back to welding as an example. So in 2017, the World Health Organization, International Agency for Research on Cancer, identified welding fumes of any sort as being a cause of lung cancer and possibly kidney cancer, and also ocular melanoma. In 2019, the Health and Safety Executive asked its Work Health Expert Committee to look at this again, and they came up with the same conclusion. Now, literally, in the last week, the Health and Safety Executive and WEC have said, we're going to hold a seminar, and people can sit in and listen to whether welding fumes cause cancer or not. They've already decided it does. We don't need the science. What we need to find out is where the 175 people that the Health and Safety Executive estimates and IAC estimates suffer from cancer due to welding fumes are, why they're not being compensated, and whether or not we can, in fact, bring in measures to prevent future exposures and future diseases.
OK, thank you. Katie, do you want to follow up on anything?
Yeah, a slightly different point. In terms of the evidence earlier, there was a suggestion that there might be less personal injury cases if this body was actually recommending awards. Have you given any thought, if that was the case, it perhaps doesn't matter so much in the public sector, because at the end of the day, the money's all coming out the same pot. But in terms of the private sector, have you given any thought to that? I don't necessarily need detailed responses now, but is there anything you could point to that would assist with that? Because how do we ensure that employers are taking their responsibility, if you like?
Ian Tasker.
Yeah. I think, you know, whether it would result in a dramatic reduction in personal injury cases, I think is questionable. What we would see is potentially at lower level injuries, you know, where if people are getting compensated through industrial benefit, then they may decide not to pursue a personal injury claim through the courts, because that is obviously a very stressful time for individuals. So, you know, there may well be an advantage in relation to if people are getting adequate benefits to live with their injury, that they would decide that compensation was not something they really wanted to seek.
Any more questions?
No, it's maybe something we can think about later, but that's helpful. Yeah.
Just before we move on, I asked the same question to the last panel because it came up in last week's evidence session. There was a bit of an appeal that the membership or a strong link with occupational health across Scotland would be important in terms of collecting a lot of that data and identifying trends early in that proactive work. None of the members in the last panel particularly jumped at that when I suggested, because we heard last week the big role for occupational health. Is that something that any witness here would commend, Ian Tasker?
Yeah. You know, clearly, our submission suggested very much that we need to look at occupational health. We need to make this body proactive and preventative. Since this inception of the NHS, occupational health has always been funded by employers. Now, we need to work to develop good occupational health provision for everybody. Now, that is a way to prevent the injuries happening in the first place. It will drive down the number of people that actually have to access occupational health, to National Health Services treatments. And, you know, clearly that could potentially free up some funding from the NHS to actually make the benefits payments.
I won't push that any further. We heard it last week, so we just wanted to float it this week to see if there was any buy-in from witnesses in relation to that. We'll move on to Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I really appreciate your time here this morning. I wanted to continue on covering the issue of timing in this session in relation to industrial injuries policy. In general, things have moved extremely slow. I mentioned in the previous session that we're basically inheriting a warehouse full of papers and legislation. It's really been left unreformed, really, since you know, its inception, all the way back in the kind of late 20s. To guide us on how we can bring a quicker change to Scotland, do any witnesses want to comment on the reasons for sort of little progress that has been made at UK level? And do you think that's due to a lack of expertise or just a lack of will for reform? Or do you think it's a mix of both? And I'll just pop it out to Ian first, thanks.
I think I was struck in the evidence from the IAC chair when she said that industrial, I'm paraphrasing here, but industrial injuries benefit is a political decision. And I think that's been part of the problem over the years, as successive governments have just ignored industrial injuries benefit. And that's resulted in a committee that really doesn't get the scrutiny that other organisations, other NDBBs get in relation to triennial reviews. So really they've been allowed to go on doing the same thing. There was a, as far back as 2007, David Walters, who's from Cardiff University, he carried out a review of various systems across European countries, and in relation to, and it might not be surprising, that the UK, in his view, the UK system was the worst, and he went on to say it allows for considerably lower benefits that are not earnings related and represents lower proportional expenditure on this form of support for workers harmed at work than found elsewhere in Europe. Furthermore, it makes no provision for either prevention or rehabilitation. That was in 2007. Now we're 16 years down the line and nothing's changed with the IIAC. That's why in the transfer of this it is up absolutely right that it's done safely and securely, but we should not be transferring an underfunded, not that we, you know, we're in a situation where an underfunded benefit is being forced on the Scottish Parliament.
Can I just come back on that? Obviously, due to the complexity, you know, obviously the securing safe and secure transfer of the existing cases. Do you think that approach will kind of alter the timescale required for the instruction of the Scottish Council? Just in your last comment there, I thought I would come back on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think I first got involved in the potential transfer of industrial injuries disabled benefit when I was at the SDUC. That was in 2016 when the first expert group was set up. So, you know, we're now 7 years down the line and we're having these discussions now. So, you know, I think we have to move with some speed, if that's possible, to address some of the inequalities in the system. We wouldn't like to see, obviously, as part of that, any people who are actually currently in benefit being impacted on that. But the advantage of setting up an advisory committee before the Scottish Government consultation takes place, is they can start to work on that and make recommendations to the Scottish Government on how this should be shaped moving forward. Because we can't have what is happening down in Westminster. It's just, that's not sustainable.
Tony?
Yeah, just on that point, that we've been working in close consultation with the PFA in England on this, and they have greater resources and been working on it for a few years now. And they made some informal inquiries of the IAC at Westminster, through Westminster, and they were sort of told informally it could be between 1 and 2 decades is the normal before a decision is reached in this. And so reality for us is that while we're still working with Westminster, I've been working closely with cross-party with Ian Blackford and Douglas Ross, and what we're trying to do is stimulate the politicians to push IAC to make a decision. We think we have considerable evidence from 3 or 4 countries that substantiate our view, but the reality is that how long will that take for a decision to be made? So I think in Scotland we have the opportunity through our own system, a new system, that of a quicker process, because whether it will be rejected or not, I think we understand, certainly in our case with the players with dementia, it's their families who are the ones that are suffering on a daily basis. So the quicker we can get it through properly, the better. But I was really dismayed when they told me that could be the length of time. We have to rely on the IAC system at the moment. But of course we are. We had a debate in Westminster for 3 hours when we have it on the minister's agenda. So hopefully we can move it quicker. But for many other industries, that's not always possible.
Thanks for that, Professor. You want to come in?
Yes. Could I just endorse what Ian has said about IAC? In 2015, we looked at the occupational diseases that were listed by the ILO and within Europe, and we looked at the IAC list, and there were a very significant number of diseases that were recognised elsewhere that IAC hadn't acted upon. And this is partly, and I think you heard about this from the chair of IAC, it's partly because they have this approach about you must show double the risk. And in the Social Security Act, there is no reference whatsoever to double the risk. There's a reference to reasonable certainty. And I recently spoke to an IAC member who'd gone through the minutes, and they said in the minutes the statement that they had seen was that you compensated for an occupational disease if it said more likely than not. Effectively, we're talking about more down the balance of probabilities end than the beyond reasonable doubt end. Now, this doesn't mean you automatically compensate people, but if you don't list the disease and you don't identify the disease, then nobody's going to be compensated. And just to reiterate the points that John McKenzie was making, then there'll be no action taken in the future to address this problem. Literally this week, there have been 3 outputs that demonstrate, I think, the failures of IAC. HSE picks up the disease problems and then nothing happens. Just in the last 3 days, a report has come out that reviewed COVID as an occupational disease. 35 countries in Europe there are. 2 do not recognise COVID as an occupational disease. Moldova and the United Kingdom. I think that tells us a great deal about how the scientific evidence is being used. As I say, there may be different compensation systems, but it doesn't necessarily, and it doesn't necessarily follow that people will be automatically compensated. But that's a system where there are huge holes, and clearly SEAC could do something about addressing that.
Thanks for that. Anna, just want to comment?
Yep, thank you. I'd just like to agree with what others have said, but also take it back slightly to think about the way that the system has disbenefited women and how these delays that others have spoken about further entrench the inequalities that women have in terms of the barriers to accessing benefits in particular. And what's especially relevant is the fact that the social security system doesn't meet the needs of women, even though they're more reliant on it generally. But there's a lack of, as Ian had, I think, intimated, this lack of political will at the UK level to address that. And instead, we see further layers and layers where women's work-related ill health is invisible within that. One thing I think that is really important to think about is that the historical focus on health and safety at work has predominantly been on dangerous, what's perceived to be dangerous, visibly dangerous work within industries, which tend to be male-dominated, such as construction and mining going back further, whereas the work that women are more likely to do is deemed to be safer. But actually, the harms and risks that women experience are more invisible, they're cumulative and result in musculoskeletal conditions and stress and so on. But these things aren't recognised within the system. And until there's a proactive approach to actually try to address that, then the inequalities will continue to be baked into that system.
Thanks for that, Anna. Taking back to yourself, Professor Watson, your written submission at question 10, a SEAC is urgently needed to help advise employers and employees in Scotland to recognise the full range of industrial diseases. And you've obviously touched a bit on that already, but could you comment on the urgency of what need and also how you can see the Scottish Council fulfilling that role? And obviously you've spoken about it already, but if you could expand any further, that'd be great.
I think it's becoming more and more urgent, and I think we obviously need the good scientific medical research, and Scotland's got a lot of that. I mean, if you looked at silica, the work that respiratory physicians have done in Edinburgh, picking up problems in asymptomatic young people exposed to silica who've got silicosis, is very significant. And that begs the question then, and in fact the researchers themselves pointed this out, why aren't we bringing in more measures that will reduce the exposures and prevent the diseases? So I think it's a very big problem. This week we've seen the 2023 Health and Safety Executive Statistics come out, and on that list, in terms of worker ill health, we are actually worse than 13 other European countries. So, in fact, there's a lot of pressure there. We're often falling behind with what goes on, and we're not picking up the problems that are identified. Just picking up the point about women again, in those health and safety executive statistics, they identify what are the key self-reported groups, the ones that the sectors that suffer most occupational diseases. Health and social work, public administration, education, where we have very large numbers of, obviously, of women, often low-paid workers as well. These are all slipping through what's going on. So there's work that Scotland could do in terms of identifying the old problems, and there's also work that could be done to pick up the new ones. Again, just reflecting what John McKenzie said, the latest Health and Safety Executive Report for 2023 has got the annual costs of new work-related ill health as being £13 billion. £13 billion. That's new health, new cases. Obviously, there are the old cases. And if we looked at Scotland in that context, then we're probably talking about £1 billion each year on new occupational diseases damaging the economy. So, you know, this is why a better system will be good for employers, good for employees, good for society.
Thank you for that. Can do that to me.
No more questions? Can we move on to Katie Clark, please?
Thank you. And as you'll appreciate, the committee has been looking at whether setting up a new council in Scotland would add value, and whether there would be duplication with the ILAC council at the moment. And we've heard evidence in relation to long COVID, firefighter cancers, etc. So could you maybe say how you think this new council would relate to the existing UK body, and how we ensure that there is added value and avoid duplication? And again, maybe ask the professor, but you're in the room, Deputy Convener, so...
Katie, that's fine. My silence, because no one was willing to catch my eye there, you see. That's why there was silence. Professor Watterson.
Sorry, could you just repeat the question?
really what I'm asking is how we avoid duplication with work that's going on at a UK level and how we ensure that there's added value. You've covered a lot of that already, but particularly how we avoid duplication, I think, is something that we're concerned about.
Yes. I think it's true to say at the moment we have some duplication, which is what we've already touched on. So we've got international agencies producing reports, we've got the Health and Safety Executive producing reports, we've got IAC reviewing reports, we've got WEC then reviewing what IAC and IARC has done. So the system actually in the UK, I don't think is that efficient. So I think what we'd be looking for is something that complements and acts as a catalyst. And it could complement by picking up various sectors, certainly, but I think it could definitely complement in terms of finding out why we have these failures on silica, on welding, on women's health, and so on, looking at the workplaces that operate. And because Scotland has got a very good body of researchers and others working on health and safety, I think they'll be actually ideally placed to do that. It's because it's a smaller country. But I think it's a case of not necessarily ignoring the toxicology and epidemiology work that goes on. That may often be funded by Research Council and others. It's looking at how we're using that information and why groups are falling through the net as well. I think SEAC would be ideally placed to complement what IAC does and what's going on in the UK.
Before we move on to any other witnesses, in terms of this issue about how we apply, if you like, knowledge, in terms of the test that would be applied, there's been mention of reasonable certainty, showing the double risk test. How do you think the test that the council applies should be developed? Would that be the council itself that would do that? Is that something that the parliament needs to set in legislation? How do you think, maybe looking at other European models, how would you suggest that Scotland approaches that in terms of how we develop that test? Maybe you recommend a test today, or it may be you might recommend the process by which that test might be developed.
Do you want me to answer?
Well, I think yes, Ian caught my idea. Yeah. Well, Ian Tassel will bring Professor Watterson after that.
I mean, I think, and I take you back to the research that they commissioned and actually ignored in 2007. And that's exactly what they did. They looked at European models, they looked at Australian models, and you know, clearly there's a lot of other models other than that relative risk, including dealing with issues on a claim by a case by case basis. You know, so I think it would be important that a similar study was done, or that study was looked at to see if it was still reasonably irrelevant. But the committee should provide advice to the Scottish Government in relation to what model they wish to adopt. If we're going to really be serious about making improvements to this system, everything should be under discussion. And we think that's one of the areas of work that SEAC could concentrate on if it was constituted before the actual transference of the benefit.
Okay, so that would inform decisions that were taken thereafter. Is there any other witness, Deputy Convener?
I suppose the question is who is benefiting from that particular test and who's benefiting from the model, and so that is something that would need to be looked at. The current model that's used clearly disbenefits women and probably certain types of women, say older women, racially minoritised women, for instance. So I think that's probably a starting point to have with. I just want to come back also on the added value point that you raised, Katie, which was, I suppose, where we see it close the gap is having that dedicated research function there, which is really necessary to put more of a focus on women's occupational health. I know that the colleague from IAC had previously mentioned that there was some scoping work going on about women's occupational health. Now, women have been working in the labour market forever, and so if we're only at the scoping stage, I'm not filled with reassurance that there's going to be any substantial changes in that anytime soon. And what we need, as others have said, is a much more proactive approach to making sure that all workers in Scotland are able to benefit from that system. But particularly, I see the role in terms of remedying the injustices that have happened to workers, women workers in particular, who haven't been able to access that but still live with the cost of workplace injuries and diseases. And particularly many of those are our key workers who were so essential at that point to the pandemic response, but are undervalued in the economy and unable to access the benefit in the current system.
Any other witness want to add, Professor Watterson?
Just in terms of the test, I mean, what was in the IAC minutes was this statement about more likely than not. And I think that's been used in other countries. So why replicate the wheel? If we have lists from the ILO, an authoritative body of occupational diseases, if we have lists from the European Union, if we have data from the US and Canada about firefighters' occupational diseases, why replicate it? As I said before, it doesn't mean that they are then automatically compensated, but it's the starting point for action. I think SEAC could look at that and look at those other approaches and then start to debate with IAC and the Health and Safety Executive, possibly, why things aren't happening. Although, to be fair, the Health and Safety Executive does identify the diseases, but it's obviously not responsible for compensating them. So we don't need to reinvent the wheel on everything, but we would need to review it, as Ian says.
Ian, do you want to come back in?
I mean, I think there was something that Hugh Robertson said. He was ex-TUC, but he was also a member of IAC at the time when he was giving evidence to the Social Security Committee, and it was about the importance of establishing a SEAC before the transfer actually took place. And what he said was, if the Scottish Government were to rely on evidence-based academic reports coming from the IAC and come to a different conclusion, then problems may well arise, and we would agree with that. But he went on to say, however, if the SEAC reached a different conclusion on any proposed prescription of a condition, having considered these reports from IAC, commissioned its own research and looked at other available evidence, then that decision to prescribe a disease would be taken by the Scottish Government based on advice provided by their own experts. Now, that's how I see it's important that we actually get a SEAC, is because we can look at the other evidence from other parties and consider that along with any evidence from IAC and come to potentially a better decision in relation to prescriptions of disease than has taken in the past.
Thank you. Katie, any more questions? Okay, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I think we've touched on this in some previous answers, but previous evidence we'd heard from some of the trade unions spoke about the length of time it takes very often for IAC to make decisions or to advise. And I just wonder if there's a sense of what SEAC could do in order to make those processes quicker and perhaps more streamlined, if that is possible. I don't know if folk want to maybe give a general view of what would speed things up.
Higgins, you were very conscious, you came in earlier on top of 10 to 20 years, that the appropriate time to bring yourself in.
Yeah, well, I think that in the injury time campaign that Michael Mara was orchestrating, unfortunately can't be here today, but we talked about establishing a working group in there, because one of the issues, of course, is that if you're successful, you know, you have to work out a process of a criterion established so that, for instance, in professional football, would it be a footballer that has to be employed for a minimum of 8 years or 10 years or 6 years? So a whole variety of problems that have to be dealt with bureaucratically. So certainly in particular issues, certainly in our issue, we would have to, that's why we're creating a working party, to look at that, to establish what the criteria would be to supplement the medical evidence we're presenting to it. And I think you mentioned it, an advisory council issue as well earlier, Ian, about that, the preparation of information,
yeah,
and stuff beforehand, and certainly in terms of our industry, because it's a relatively short career, we would have to work out ourselves with the medical people what length of time a professional player, be it male or female, had to be employed in the game before they would qualify for any potential benefit.
Ian Tasker, you mentioned it.
I mean, I think it's probably connected. I mean, IAC doesn't do anything quickly, you know, and it's probably connected to the way that it's just been allowed to develop. And, you know, it goes back to the fact that it seems to have been reasonably untouched by these triennial reviews, which would investigate whether there was an issue to start moving things faster. And, you know, it just seems to be an organisation that is working at its own pace. Now, 20 years is unacceptable. If the HSE took 20 years to investigate a work-related death, you know, questions would be asked. So, you know, they're really, it's something in relation to transfer. You know, I think the Scottish Parliament is probably a better place to move things faster. I mean, there's been changes made in the Scottish Parliament that have had an impact in the UK Parliament, particularly in relation to asbestos compensation. You know, where the Scottish Parliament took decisions, there was a process that moved extremely quickly. Meant in one case that mesothelioma victims got compensation in their own lifetimes that had never happened before, and now we see that being brought in elsewhere in the UK. So this, a SEAC could influence the benefits that actually are awarded to people elsewhere in the UK by being able to act more quickly than IAC does.
Anna Richie-Allen, a theme of the glacial pace of any progress for female workers is something that you've come back to time and again. Is there anything you think SEAC could do to speed up the pace of that?
I suppose I was quite struck when reading the evidence from the IAC colleague and others that had pointed out that although they don't have a discrete research function, the research work that is done there tends to be done in the evening, so they're obviously significantly under-resourced. But I think there is something to be said about having that evidence base in place and being able to be more proactive about gathering evidence and information on women's injuries and diseases at work. And the proposal for SEAC obviously includes that discrete function, and I think that it would centre it more in the work and also complement what others have said about speeding up and Scotland really leading the way on ensuring that people have access to the benefits they need in a timely manner.
Thank you. Paul, it's your line of questioning. Do you want to follow up some of this?
Yeah, the sense I'm getting from people is that in terms of SEAC, it could be about the criteria that's put in place. I mean, when people see there being perhaps, you know, timescales attached to when an expectation of certainly reporting back or work is done in order to keep the thing on track. Because, I mean, is it a sense that the 20-year period is about, as Ian Tasker said, you know, IAC going at its own pace, or is it about there being a lack of accountability within the process, I wonder?
Yes,
I think it is. It's the situation where IAC has been totally under-resourced, you know, and that has to be the main problem that has taken so long. Alongside, potentially, I mean, we'll look at some of the reaction when it was suggested that COVID should be a prescribed disease, and the reaction from the UK government. Let's face it, it's an NDPB that's under control of a government that's not particularly trade union friendly or worker friendly. You know, so I think the political circumstances certainly affect the pace that these decisions are being made at.
Did you want to go?
I wouldn't downplay at all the importance of research and evaluation, but I go back to the point that if we have good research, we don't want to reinvent the wheel. If the World Health Organization and the International Agency for Research on Cancer can do very detailed international work, pulling in researchers from around the world and come to a conclusion, it seems crazy that we then have second guessing. And as a researcher, I would also say, and I could say it about lawyers generally, as a researcher, you ask a researcher what they want. more research, please. Whereas what we want here is where there is good research and good evidence, we actually want action. I mentioned that in 2015, we looked at what IAP was doing and what diseases it recognised, and what diseases are recognised elsewhere. Asbestos and cancer of the larynx was recognised in Norway in 1956. It's not recognised here. It's recognised in Denmark in 1986, in Austria and in Germany. France and Italy also recognised cancer of the larynx. At the time as well, there was the only listing for breast cancer in 2015 was radiation. As I say, the Health and Safety Executive were identifying shift work and the position of women there. That's not changed. It's still not changed. We've talked about COVID. We could talk about diesel exhaust. We could talk about welding and lung cancer. It would be exactly the same. So I don't think we want to reinvent the wheel. We want to ask why, where there's good evidence, hasn't action taken place. And we get research and evaluation on areas where that have been neglected. I mean, there is a great deal of evidence about women's health in the workplace, and the Health and Safety Executive have identified it as a priority. Why aren't we doing something about it?
Anna Ritchie-Allen?
Yeah, just to follow on the research point, I suppose the context is very important here. I suppose we would say that women's, and the evidence, I think, and you've recognised this within Scottish Government's Women's Health Plan, is that generally women's health is an under-researched area. It's women's ill health is under-diagnosed, under-treated, and often dismissed as something else. And we see that within the workplace context around about the old wear and tear thing about women's ill health from doing manual work, increasingly skilled manual work such as social care, for instance. And because women do the bulk of unpaid work in the home as well, and there's a lot of overlap with that type of work, that when it's done in the labour market, it can be increasingly complex to unpick that, and it's often dismissed as just general wear and tear, and women should just get on with it. I think the point around UK government is well made in terms of the political decisions it's taken. The UK government over the course of a number of years does not have a reputation for doing good things for women's equality, and actually has taken action that has exacerbated the inequalities that women face. And in COVID, I think we need to recognise the gender dimensions of that as well, with women being more exposed to COVID during the pandemic, as the vast majority of our key workers, but also being more likely to have long COVID as well. And then the further systemic barriers which disadvantage them, such as having less access to sick pay, reduced access to being able to claim this type of benefit, not having sufficient time to recover, having a caring role, and being more at risk of poverty. All of these factors compound to increase the inequality that women face both in the workplace and outside of the workplace.
Okay, thank you. Tony Higgins, did you want to come in?
No, thank you.
Okay. Paul, any more questions?
I'm very grateful. I appreciate the exchange we've just had in terms of resourcing and in terms of research. And I appreciate John Mason's going to come on, I think, to talk more broadly about the finances. But I just wonder, in terms of the funding of research, you know, there is challenges in terms of, as Ian says, I think the broader resourcing, but in terms of actually funding that research. So I don't know if Professor Watson has a view about the level of investment required in terms of being able to do research within the kind of SEAC proposal, if you like?
Well, I think the Health and Safety Executive has its own research programme and research facilities that could feed in. As we've mentioned, there's already a lot of research going on that isn't necessarily funded through the IAC structure. There are opportunities there to identify problem areas and to try and fill them. But sometimes research in inverted commas could mean not necessarily doing detailed clinical, toxicological, epidemiological work. It could be looking at the organisation and delivery and the problems of exclusion You know, that would be a legitimate area. And research councils and others could do that. I see there's been a little bit of movement post-Brexit about Britain being able to participate in some European research. But clearly a lot of work is going on in this area elsewhere that Scottish researchers, you know, could get involved in, and indeed are involved in. It was noticeable that Sir Patrick Vallance praised the research of an Edinburgh researcher in terms of getting health data together, you know, with regard to COVID. So there will be complementary strands operating.
Okay, no more questions? Yeah. Before we bring in John Mason, I was going to look at finances. I'm conscious that was the last line of questioning. So before we go to that, I mean, clearly it's self-evident this bill will pass or it won't, but are there certain things this bill will achieve that must happen irrespective of whether it's passed? I'm thinking the bill may be passed or it may not, but the research must still happen. The bill may be passed or it may not, but whether the criteria for getting on that list is genderised appropriately or not needs to be reviewed. So from each of your perspectives, this is an opportunity, if there's something you want to maybe say at this point about what must happen in relation to industrial injuries and making sure people are properly compensated, this might be a good time to do it, because I'm conscious once we got into talking about the finances of it, that takes us down a different avenue, but we have to robustly scrutinise the finances underpinning the legislation as well. Is there any comments anyone would like to make at this stage in relation to that? Tony Higgins.
I mean, up to now, certainly the research that's been conducted in professional football, it's been largely funded by the game itself, and many would argue, particularly at the top of the game, that's the thing to do. But I would have concerns about maybe other industries who don't have that ability to galvanise public support or support of other people for research, and certainly something that SEAC could look at. I don't know if it's possible within the new bill, but again, our research, even the research we've had from other countries, has been funded by the game itself, maybe in conjunction with the government. There's three or four other pieces of research going on at the moment, which the PFAs have helped fund, the governing bodies. In the Scottish case, the Scottish Government have put some funding into it as well. So I think it's really important that research is conducted, but also, for smaller industries where that finance might not be available, it would be really interesting to see if that those fundings could be provided.
That's helpful. Any other comments, Ian Tasker?
Yeah, just going back to the speech that the first Social Security Minister made in 2016, she said that they wanted to ensure that every single person was treated with compassion, with dignity and fairness and with respect, and nothing less will be tolerated. With a massive amount of people not getting access to compensation for their workplace injuries, that will not be met unless SEAC or whatever, if SEAC, the bill is not passed, the inequalities in the system has to be addressed.
Important to put on the record, and also gives me the opportunity to put on the record that the timescale at the moment is the last agency agreement between DWP and the Scottish Government in relation to the current payments, as I think is the financial year 2025-2026, which kind of gives us a timescale for whether it's this bill or Scottish Government legislation that we're kind of looking at, I suppose, within this place. But that's a point well made. I will pass on to the financial aspects of it, unless Anna Richie-Allen. Thank you.
Thank you. I suppose just wanted to highlight the tension there, and we've seen Scottish Government commit to doing things differently with the devolution of the social security powers that it has, and particularly around ensuring that equality and non-discrimination were embedded in the Social Security Charter. But there is a tension there with the approach, which is the safe and secure transition, which in this, to some degree, will at least be business as usual. But all that is just replicating a system that disadvantages women and increases the inequality that they face both in social security and in the workplace. One other thing I wanted to mention that needs to change is the way that violence and harassment in the workplace is framed, and particularly from a gendered perspective. Although men are in the workplace are more likely to be affected by a one-off physical assault, women are far more likely to experience bullying, harassment, and and violence, particularly because so many women work in customer service roles, public facing. But I think the point around sexual harassment is really important to note here as well, with women being overwhelmingly the majority of sexual harassment victim survivors and men overwhelmingly being the perpetrators. And it's endemic in workplace, and yet it's not seen as a health and safety issue. And so within the wider discourse around health and safety at work, there needs to be much more of a focus on the impacts and the harms and the risks of sexual harassment at work and how that can be prevented and mitigated against.
Thank you. We'll now pass to... So, Mr Tasker, did you want to come in there? I was going to pass to...
We've been doing some work with the S2C Women's Committee on sexual harassment at work, and it's quite clear the HSE have admitted that they don't investigate sexual harassment at work. It's the that is the role of the Equal Opportunities Commission, but they don't do it either. You know, so there is a big issue in relation to who takes responsibility. The Police Scotland don't even know where a Sexual Harassment Act has been related to work or taken place in the workplace.
Okay, thank you very much to our witnesses. Mr Mason, thank you for your patience. I'll pass to you now.
Thanks very much, Convener. So, yes, on to finances. I don't know if you heard some of the previous questions at the end of the last session. But first of all, what's actually in the financial memorandum is the set-up costs of £149,000. Now, I don't know if any of you are IT experts, but that includes £50,000 for IT and website set-up. And I just wonder if you think that's going to be enough. And then similarly, on the running costs, which are expected to be £372,000 per year, and Paul O'Kane already mentioned research is less than 10% of that at £30,000, so it seems quite a small amount. So have you any thoughts about these figures, and are they reasonable or unreasonable? Somebody said IAC was under-resourced. Was that you, Ms Allen?
Yes, it does seem to be under-resourced. I don't have many comments to make on the specifics of the costs that are allocated for each of the set-up costs, but I suppose thinking about the initial investment, but what the longer-term benefits of that will be for women in the workplace, but also all workers in particular. The £30,000 research proposed budget for that is, I suppose, thinking about discrete research projects that are commissioned, is not that much. But as Andrew said, there's a number of other channels that can be taken to do further work on research in terms of looking at existing research, bringing together other stakeholders on that and so on. So I don't have any specific comments on set-up costs, though.
Anyone else? Salaries, 175,000.
I think when I read the financial memorandum, obviously these figures have been taken from similar past experience, yeah. You know, which I think is right, and it's probably about the only model you really can use. I think the research budget is low, but I think there's potentially better ways, as Andrew has also obviously said, of using the expertise we've got. The Fire Brigades Union, for instance, when they gave evidence, told about the research they'd commissioned in relation to their decon campaign, which is excellent research. Now, and Andrew mentioned the HSE research. If you go on the HSE website, there's hundreds of pieces of research that should be connected to industrial injury compensation investigations, but it just sits there on a website. So, you know, 30,000, I think everybody would obviously, if there's more available, we'd take it. But I think there's ways of actually ensuring that any SEAC has good quality research placed in front of them when they're considering their work.
OK. So the next question is, if SEAC gets set up and if there's all this unmet demand out there, including for women and football injuries and all the rest of it, does that inevitably mean that the amount of benefit we pay out will increase? Nobody volunteering? Professor Watson, do you think?
Well, I mean, I think there's a general issue here. I mean, in some respects, the sums seem modest. Obviously, they'll be evaluated. But if the the body works. It's actually going to be, one, helping to ensure social justice for those people who've been affected by occupational diseases, their communities, and also it's going to have significant benefits, I think, for the National Health Service and others as well, because it will be identifying where there are problems. So there'll be cost savings, because what we know at the moment is bad employers, be they in the public or private sector, actually externalise the costs of occupational disease and injury. And I just indicated earlier some of the figures, and they're absolutely huge. So if the system's working, what you would expect is gradually then the benefits to go down, because it would be feeding in to what the regulators are doing and the knowledge of the employers to control the problems and so on. So in the middle term, you would expect it actually to be greatly reducing the costs. But yes, in the short term, it may be that the costs go up. But as we heard in the previous session, you know, I mean, that is a big social justice issue. At the moment, the people who suffer the problems aren't properly compensated, and we all pay for poor ill health in the workplace.
I mean, so yes, I get your point that in the long run there might be savings, say, to the health service, but at the moment we're looking at a budget of something like 78 million in benefits. The Scottish Government does not have any spare money that I'm aware of to pay for, but we could say, well, let's take it off the health service because they'll save in the long run. But, I mean, is it worthwhile having this council if we're still stuck with 78 million?
Well, I mean, I think you want to address the problem. So in the middle and long term, absolutely. And it will give a focus. And there should be spin-offs that should allow more effective actions elsewhere to be taken. I mean, that, but others will have another view.
Mr. Tasker.
I think, if we look at who actually pays the cost of occupational ill health, Andrew mentioned the latest figures of £1.3 billion. Government pays very little of that. The cost does not fall on the government. It does not fall on the employers. £750 billion of that falls on individuals and their families. You know, so that, when we're talking sums, you know, that's staggering. That is absolutely staggering that employers don't really have to pay in relation to the harm they cause. We tend to support a polluter pays principle. You know, the people that are causing the harm should have to pay, not only for the compensation through civil courts, but if there was a mechanism to actually ensure that they're contributing towards these benefit payments.
Oh, help do that, or is that entirely employment law reserved to Westminster?
Well, I think if we look at, and clearly the bill in relation to recovery of costs for personal injury, and then there was a more recent one that didn't seem to go anywhere in relation to recovery of costs for occupational disease. Now, that's recovery of costs going into the NHS, but depending on how much that recovery of costs, the sum involved in that recovery of costs, could that not be used to actually provide some funding to improve the benefit system?
Okay. I don't know if yourself, Ms. Allen, I mean, do you think this inevitably means an increase in the benefits paid out?
Potentially, I don't know. But I suppose I would agree with, just because it's going to cost more or there's going to be a higher cost doesn't mean it shouldn't be done. Because the consequences of not doing this, I think, are vast. And what we see, I think it really does undermine Scottish Government ambitions on tackling poverty, child poverty, which is interlinked with women's poverty. But because there's women now who can't work, can't access benefits, and so are inactive in the labour market because of a work-related injury or illness, but also can't access those benefits. And these two things are at odds with each other. And so I would agree with what others have said in that the longer-term benefits need to really be thought about from that preventative approach about how we actually realise a Scotland that is founded on social justice, where poverty is eradicated and where equality is realised.
And would you agree then with the SDUC, whose argument would be we should raise taxes to pay for that?
We are supportive of progressive taxation, yes.
Okay. Mr. Higgins?
Yeah, just on that, John, just following Andrew's point that, again, I'm not a politician and politicians are elected to make decisions on finance. And that's why we elect you. So you're throwing it back at us to answer. But in terms of the change in the industry, what we've recognised by our research is a change in the rules of the game and the regulations through concussion, the treatment of children, the treatment of women. So that's a byproduct that has arrived in the last 3 or 4 years, changes at local level and at FIFA level. So hopefully in the next 2 or 3 generations there'll be less dementia encountered by players during their career, male or female. So that would be a saving then on the health service.
So we didn't push that process forward, this council?
Yeah. That, because industry would look at how they can provide better security for their workers. Certainly that's happened in professional football, which you know is a very capitalist situation, but they do recognise that they have responsibilities. In American sport, they have no-fault liability, where they, because they have so much revenue, they set a pool of money aside, and if a player develops dementia, he automatically qualifies for that without having to go through any process. So I think that if we can throw it back and the moral responsibility on the employers, we can get more funds derived to look after these professional athletes.
OK. Professor Watson, did you want to come back in?
Just a very quick point. The system should fairly quickly benefit good employers, because what happens at the moment is good employers are penalised by bad employers having poor working conditions. The Health and Safety Executive, over a period of time, has produced various reports on the costs of ill health, and they've estimated at various times that it's 1 year's economic growth. And if you ask MAKE, you know, the successor to the Engineering Employers Federation or the Federation of Small Businesses, they all say they want to see better occupational health. So this is sort of part of the picture, I think. And then there would be various cost savings and benefits, insurance and other things that would come into play.
OK. Thanks, Camino.
Thank you. Time is almost upon us, and I forgot to say this to the first panel. If there's anything burning within you, you just have to get on the official report before we close this evidence session, as long as it's brief, of course. You have the opportunity to do that now.
Just one point in relation to the very last act that DACBEG did was to send a letter to the minister. And part of one of their recommendations, and a long list of recommendations, and it was quite a strong recommendation, was that there should be a SEAC set up.
Okay, thank you. And you've put that on the official report. Mr. Higgins.
It's cross-party here, so please support our injury time campaign across the Parliament.
Thank you. I think there's an event recently we're all hoping to attend to learn more. I had more questions I wanted to ask, but I didn't want to take the session specifically in that direction. So thank you, Mr. Higgins, for drawing that to our attention. Any other comments before I close the session? OK. All that remains for me to do then is to thank all four of you for your evidence this morning. And, of course, the first panel we had earlier on, that concludes our public business for today. And we'll now move into a private session. Thank you.